Hello everyone, I am the Bedhead Kirby, and welcome to my channel, The Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic the Gathering format. The Brewery is a series on this channel showcasing my spicy brews under the deck text. On this episode of The Brewery, I'll be discussing my take on a commander from Zendikar Rising, Verosol, the Split Current. If you like this deck or any of the cards I'll be mentioning throughout the video, please consider using my TCG Player affiliate link when purchasing those cards. You can find that link down in the description. It'll really help out the channel. The best way you can help support the channel is with my Patreon. For just $1, patrons get early access to scheduled videos on YouTube, and higher tier patrons get access to the VIP section of my Discord server as well. You can find a link to both down in the description. Alright, let's get back to the episode. Verosol is a 0/0 serpent for X generic, 1 green and 1 blue. With the way Verosol's +1/+1 counter ability is worded, that means that it doesn't enter the battlefield with just X +1/+1 counters, but with as many +1/+1 counters as mana spent to cast it. That means that X equals 0 will still enter the battlefield with 2 +1/+1 counters because you still spent 1 green and 1 blue mana to cast it. Also, if you spent commander text to cast it, that also counts. So casting it multiple times from the command zone only makes it bigger. So that's not only amazing, but super important to keep in mind. Not only are these +1/+1 counters useful to make Verosol an insane threat via Voltron, but it also goes with its second ability. Whenever you cast a kick spell, you may remove 2 +1/+1 counters from Verosol. If you do, it copies that spell. If the spell was a permanent, it creates a copy token of that permanent. This would make Verosol a good commander for a Kickers Matters deck, but honestly, that's not a really good deck. I would rather see Verosol as a way to make good kicker spells better, not as a way to jam as many kicker spells as possible in a deck. That being said, this deck is all about big mana, so we can get a huge Verosol to smash face with, as well as potentially copying the best kicker spells in its colors too. That being said, let's see which kicker spells I've included in my brew. Even though it's not optimal to dedicate an entire deck solely to Verosol's kicker-related ability, that doesn't mean we shouldn't capitalize it with some amazing kicker spells that are great regardless if we control Verosol or not. Everflowing Chalice and Skyclave Relic immediately come to mind. On their own, they're amazing mana rocks, but with Verosol on the battlefield with enough +1/+1 counters, it can copy these mana rocks for further value. In the case of Everflowing Chalice, the copy enters the battlefield with the same amount of charge counters as the original ones. Copying a kicked Skyclave Relic is even more busted. Doing so provides you with 2 untapped relics and 4 tapped copies for a total of 6 Skyclave relics on the battlefield that will survive all mass artifact hate spells like Vandal Blast, Austere Command, etc. Thieving Skydiver is also technically a mana rock since kicking it for just 1 additional mana makes it steal Soul Rings, Mana Vaults, and Mana Crypts, so it's definitely a great card regardless of Verosol. However, with Verosol copying it, the copy also steals a mana rock, so you can get 2 Soul Rings all for just 3 mana. Kicking Primal Growth means only sacrificing one creature to then ramp for up to 4 basic lands that will enter the battlefield untapped, all for just 3 mana. Even without Verosol, this is still a decent ramp spell. We can also draw tons of cards with this ability. Into the Rule and Blink of an Eye will not only bounce 2 different non-land permanents, making them great tempo pieces as well as responses, but you'll also draw 2 cards too, all for just 4 mana if Verosol is on the battlefield. Also, they're still good on their own. Sphinx of Lost Truths is not an amazingly good card, but if you hold onto it until you can kick it with Verosol on the battlefield, then for 7 mana you get 2, 3, 5 flyers and draw 6 cards. Drawing 6 cards for 7 mana is already good value, so getting 2 flyers on top of that is just icing on the cake. Inscription of Abundance is another great response spell if you're able to kick it. What's great about this with Verosol is that it will replace the 2 +1/+1 counters it lost and then gives it 2 more. You then get to have your biggest creature fight 2 other creatures or 2 versus 2 as great creature removal. You can then gain a lot of life if Verosol is insanely huge. That provides a great buffer for holding out from other aggro decks while taking out opponents. Kicking Maddening Cacophony is another way to aggravate opponents. With Verosol out, you're milling half their deck twice, rounding up each time. This means that you are potentially leaving them with about 25% left of their library. While this is not a mill deck, milling the entire table for 75% of their library for just 6 mana is too good to pass up. At the very least, it's an incredibly disruptive effect against non-graveyard dependent decks. The final kicker spell in the deck is Rite of Replication, which is just insanity if you can copy this with Verosol. Pretty soon we're going to see some of the epic creatures in the deck, and being able to copy any of them 10 times is not only win more, but potentially game ending. The deck also has ways to duplicate tokens, so Verosol's copying effect is even more busted. Since the deck's creating tokens and playing with +1/+1 counters thanks to Verosol being at the helm, why not make the most of both of these effects? Doubling Season and Primal Vigor do just that. Both of these enchantments will not only double the amount of +1/+1 counters Verosol enters the battlefield with, but any tokens created will be doubled. So if you had any of these already on the battlefield when you kicked something like Rite of Replication with Verosol in play, you're essentially getting 20 token copies of the creature. With both on the battlefield, that becomes a whopping 40. Since these enchantments don't specify that the tokens have to be creatures, they will also double the amount of Everflowing Chalice tokens and Skyclave Relic tokens that are created. Keep in mind when playing with Primal Vigor though, since its effect is symmetric and can help out dedicated token decks more than you. Branching Evolution is a third way of ensuring that Verosol enters the battlefield with double the amount of +1/+1 counters, as well as doubling any +1/+1 counters placed on my creatures afterwards from other effects. I'm running this over Parallel Lives since the former is more synergistic with the deck, which is more focused on +1/+1 counters and aggro than being focused on tokens. Verwell of the Hawkclade, Colonian Hydra, and Hydra's Growth are more ways of doubling the amount of +1/+1 counters on Verosol. Hydra's Growth puts a +1/+1 counter on Verosol when entering the battlefield, so that's a bonus. And then at the beginning of our upkeep, it doubles the amount of +1/+1 counters on it, which is amazing. Colonian Hydra takes it a step further by doubling the +1/+1 counters on all of our creatures when it attacks. It doesn't even have to deal combat damage, it triggers on attack. This makes our creatures even bigger before blockers are even declared. Verwell doesn't have the timing restrictions of the other two, since you can activate him at instant speed to double the amount of counters on Verosol. This is great to use as a combat trick or at the end of the turn before ours. Solidarity of Heroes and Invigorating Surge are also instant speed ways of doubling the amount of +1/+1 counters on Verosol. If an opponent doesn't block Verosol expecting not to die from commander damage, cast these in response to the damage step of the combat phase to take out that hapless opponent from the match. Forgotten Ancient is another way to put a ton of +1/+1 counters on Verosol. Not only does it trigger whenever we cast spells, but when opponents do as well. In a 4-player match, it's bound to get huge, so you can either use it as another beater, or use it to make Verosol insanely huge at the beginning of our upkeep. Or you can also distribute those +1/+1 counters to go for a going wide strategy instead of a going tall one. If we are going tall, Lightning Greaves and Swiftfoot Boots both help Verosol hit the ground running. If we had to recast Verosol in a future turn, but had enough mana to make it very dangerous, these help us make it swing that same turn. They also protect it against spot removal, which is great. Keep in mind that the Greaves won't let us target it with our own effects though. Whispersnail Cloak, Rogue's Passage, and Thassa, God of the Sea are more ways of guaranteeing Verosol breaking through by making it unblockable. Rogue's Passage might be a bit expensive in terms of mana, but it is harder to deal with for being a land, which is also great for us since it doesn't really take up a slot in the deck. Whispersnail Cloak also gives the benefit of Shroud, but again, keep in mind that it prevents us from targeting Verosol too. Thassa is amazing in this deck because she can also be used to filter our draw each turn, which is great. Now, if we do want to go wide, the deck has plenty of support for that too, if we have the kind of game where mid-range is the way to go. Nylea, God of the Hunt gives our entire board trample, so if we've been distributing +1/+1 counters and doubling them, etc., then we can get a bunch of creatures breaking through. She also has a mana sink that can be used to give a creature +2/+2. While we can use this to pump Verosol for the needed amount of commander damage points to win the game, it can also be used on any creature that manages to break through. Pathbreaker Ibex is another way to give our board trample, but it has to be used in the attack for that to happen. But that's not a problem since it gives all of our creatures, including itself, +X/+X, where X is the greatest power amongst creatures we control. If Verosol just happens to be large, say 11/11, then all of our creatures get +11/+11, including Verosol. So that makes it big enough to potentially win via commander damage. However, if we have enough creatures, then all of them gaining +11/+11 and trample might be enough to win the game anyways. Dragon Throne of Tarkir is another way to give all of our creatures a huge boost if Verosol is large enough. Unfortunately, it gives Verosol Defender, but if it's better to go wide than tall, then attacking with Verosol might not even be necessary. It gives all other creatures +X/+X and Trample, where X is its power, so this is another effect similar to Pathbreaker Ibex. Overwhelming Stampede does the same but in sorcery form. It's a solid spell for its mana cost and also gets the job done, so it's great redundancy for the deck when we want to go wide instead of tall, but still taking advantage of an immense Verosol. However, that beater doesn't have to be Verosol. Mana Gorger Hydra can get insanely huge when left unchecked. It can easily be used to take out an opponent with all of the +1/+1 counter hijinxes in the deck. It can also be the biggest creature we control as far as the Ibex and Dragon Throne are concerned. In any case, this card is amazing on its own too. Fungal Sprouting is another amazing way to make the most of a fatty we have on the battlefield. I had mentioned that the deck isn't entirely focused on tokens, but that doesn't mean that the deck creates no tokens. Fungal Sprouting has the potential of creating a wave of sapperlings for just 4 mana. This wave of sapperlings can then benefit from the previously seen effects of getting +X/+X and trample from having that same fatty that created them to begin with. They also serve as bodies to hold +1/+1 counters if we're then able to keep duplicating them. Speaking of which, Leyland of Abundance, Sword of Truth and Justice, and Karn's Bastion all help in getting those +1/+1 counters on there. Granted, there have to already be +1/+1 counters on the creatures for the Sword and the Bastion to proliferate them, but at least the Sword can help in protecting Verosol, potentially making it unblockable by white and or blue creatures, as well as continuing to make it bigger. The ley line, on the other hand, is another way of placing +1/+1 counters on all of our creatures. If that weren't enough, it also helps our mana dorks, generating an extra green mana as a bonus. Speaking of which, Verisol has the potential of being an insanely large danger noodle. Since casting it is a mana sink in and of itself, having multiple ways of accelerating our mana will be crucial. Birds of Paradise, Llanowar Elves, Finnhorn Elves, and Elvish Mystic are the 1-drop mana dorks in the deck. These are your standard run-of-the-mill mana dorks for those turn 1 plays. The best mana dork, though, in the deck is Silvala, Heart of the Wilds. Not only can she generate a ton of mana early on if we can cast a huge Verisol, but she also draws us a card whenever we have a fatty enter the battlefield, assuming it's the fattest fatty, of course. Next come the Mana Rocks. Soul Ring, Mana Crypt, Mana Vault, and Basalt Monolith. Recall that the deck's also running Everflowing Chalice and Skyclave Relic, so these aren't the only Mana Rocks in the deck. However, these cheap Mana Rocks can provide a ton of colorless mana in the early game to really sink into Verisol's X part of its casting cost. Kinnan Bonder Prodigy and Nyx Bloom Ancient are included to further take advantage of the mana sources in the deck. Kinnan makes our non-land mana sources produce an additional mana of that type when tapped. However, the Elemental provides an insane boost in mana. It doesn't have things tapped for additional mana, it simply has them tapped for triple that mana. Soul Ring taps for 6 colorless mana, Mana Vault taps for 9 colorless mana, etc. If that weren't enough, it's also a 5/5 trampler, which is relevant for this deck. Kinnan is also relevant by having a built-in mana sink and being the only human in the deck, meaning that any creature we find with it will enter the battlefield. Farseek, Nature's Lore, and 3 Visits are my favorite ramp trifecta, so they're naturally in the deck. Imperial Recruiter has been reprinted a couple of times, so I have my hopes for 3 Visits, being as it's a common and just a functional reprint of Nature's Lore, which has been reprinted a bunch of times. However, we also need that mana in order to play our spells while also keeping mana up for responses. Being blue gives us access to Force of Will, Pact of Negation, Swan Song, Negate, Counterspell, and Mana Drain as our suite of counter magic. Each of these are easy enough to cast and take care of most things that can hinder the deck. Mana Drain, which has unfortunately doubled in price in only a couple of months, is especially good here if we counter a bomb, since that colorless mana can be sunk into casting Verisol. Cyclonic Rift can help bounce everything we have encountered, as well as clearing the board for our Voltron win or our Horde win. Recall that Cyclonic Rift isn't the only bounce spell in the deck, since Blink of an Eye and Into the Royal are also in here. Whelming Wave is another mass bounce spell in the deck. Kraken, Leviathan, Octopus, and Serpent are niche enough creatures that chances are we bounce all creatures on the board except for Verisol, clearing the path for an easy Voltron victory against an opponent. Beast Within is a more permanent way to deal with a permanent than bouncing it. They might get a 3-3 for their trouble, but that's not any kind of threat for us. Meanwhile, Heroic Intervention protects our board against similar effects. Not only do all of our permanents gain indestructible, but hexproof as well. When cast in response to a board wipe, that player actually does us a favor by clearing the board and leaving only our horde behind to take care of business. Mystic Sanctuary is included as a way to recover any of these responses or other instants and sorceries in the graveyard. The deck's running 4 fetch lands that can get this onto the battlefield at instant speed, so it's great to fetch 4 in response to drawing a card. Now that I mentioned drawing cards, the deck does a fantastic way of drawing cards so we don't run out of steam. Soul's Majesty, Rishkar's Expertise, and Return of the Wild Speaker are beyond crazy here with all of the fatties we can have at any time, especially with Verisol. Return of the Wild Speaker being especially useful since we can cast it on the turn before ours if we didn't need to use our responses that turn. Rishkar's Expertise is especially useful since we can free cast something afterwards with it. As always, bonus points for chaining it into Soul's Majesty or Return of the Wild Speaker. Prime Speaker Zagana has a similar effect when she enters the battlefield. Add to that the fact that she actually becomes that big as well, and you have yet another beater for the deck, whether for going tall or to use as a base to pump the whole board to go wide. As for classic independent card draw, Stroke of Genius, Blue Sun Zenith, and Pull from Tomorrow are in the deck. With the amount of mana this deck can generate, casting these at the end of the turn before yours will more than fill your hand in order to get those win cons, as well as responses, to protect said win cons. Rhystic Study is another classic card draw piece with the potential of drawing us sufficient cards to make it worth including. Some players pay the tax, but with how ahead we're going to be in terms of mana, opponents aren't going to want to stay any further behind by having their spells taxed, so it's win-win for us. Thought Vessel and Reliquary Tower are included to help us keep our fat hands. Neither really take up a slot in the deck since the Vessel is a cheap mana rock that can help accelerate the deck, and the Tower is a mana-producing land that does not enter the battlefield tapped. The rest of the deck is just the rest of the lands. The deck's running all 8 fetch lands, Tropical Island, Breeding Pool, Hinterland Harbor, Rejuvenating Springs, Command Tower, Reflecting Pool, Flooded Grove, Jemavaya Coast, Waterlogged Grove, City of Brass, Mana Confluence, Ancient Tomb, and Temple of the False God, as well as 5 of each snow-covered basic land in case anyone's running anything that benefits us for it. As always, Tropical Island is not entirely necessary for the deck to run, and you can just as easily swap it out for anything else. Same goes for the more expensive fetch lands, but fortunately, they're going to be significantly reprinted in Modern Horizons 2, which is not supposed to be a reprint set, but who cares, they're reprinting the fetch lands. This brew is just an idea of how to build around Verisol the Split Current. What I love most about this deck is that depending on the kind of game you're playing, you can win via Voltron or Stompy or even a combination of both by taking out one opponent with Verisol and the other two with the rest of your creatures. Verisol also makes the good kicker spells even better, which is definitely a plus. The deck is definitely mid-range, especially considering we're able to protect our win cons as well as preventing opponents from winning with their own. If you're interested in the decklist of this spicy brew of mine, you can find a link to it down in the description. I would like to thank all my patrons for supporting me, and a quick shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage. I'd also like to thank anyone using my TCG Player affiliate link, that also helps out the channel. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of The Brewery on the Commander Tavern. I am the Benedict Kirby, and happy brewing.